Hello, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Exotic Astrology. Nice to see you back again. And today we are here to discuss the retrograde of Saturn, which is happening as per drigpanchang.com. This is Central European time, CET, and 11th May 2020 this year, Monday at 6:09 a.m. Saturn will be retrograde in Uttarashada Nakshatra, and he shall stay for 142 days in Uttarashada Nakshatra only, within Capricorn also, and he will get progressive on 28th September, Monday. All right, so the total duration is 142 days, so quite some time, I would say. All right, so May 11th, it goes retrograde, and September 28th, it starts progression. And therefore, around 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th, 13th May, these days will be very prominent because Saturn will be stationary. And 8th, 9th, 10th, he will be stationary direct. And then 11th, 12th, 13th, he will be stationary retrograde. And from 13th, 14th onwards, he will start his retrogression. And same goes with September. 25th, 26th, 27th, 28th will be stationary retrograde. And 28th, 29th, 30th will be stationary direct. Okay, because Saturn stays stationary for quite some time, almost 2 days. And therefore, prominent events happen in our life depending on the houses which Saturn rules in our horoscope, according to our ascendant, Lagna, rising sign, not moon sign. Okay. So therefore, this transit is a very important transit of Saturn. And like it happened for Sagittarius in 2017, Saturn had gone back to the sign of Scorpio, if you remember, in July 2017. But this time it's not happening like that. Saturn will be staying in around 1 degree of Capricorn when it reaches the final retrogression. So therefore, it will still be in Uttarashada. So therefore, Saturn is not going back to Sagittarius like it did to Scorpio in case of Sagittarius, and it is also not going back to Purva Ashada Nakshatra. Therefore, all the limelight is in Uttarashada Nakshatra this time. So how do you know what effects you will face because of this transit? Well, that will depend on your individual horoscope, your individual planets, which house Capricorn is, which house Saturn rules in your chart, and which house Sun rules in your chart. Which house Sun rules in your chart, because Sun only rules one sign. Why do I say Sun? Well, of course, because Sun is the Lord of Uttarashada Nakshatra. The Nakshatra Lord is very crucial regard when it comes to this transit, every transit indeed. And it will also depend on where your Sun is, and is your Sun conjunct Saturn, or if Sun is conjunct Rahu, Ketu, or Jupiter. And of course, nonetheless, where your Saturn is in the birth chart, in your original birth chart, right? Therefore, and this is the planetary indications, planetary wise you can know. And ultimately, of course, as I say 1,000 times, it will finally depend on your dashas, which dashas you are running as per Vimshottari. If you are running Saturn or Sun Mahadasha or Antardasha, this male, then this transit will be very prominent. And if you are, or could be Pratyantara also, but Sun Pratyantaras are very small. So I would say Sun Mahadasha, Saturn Mahadasha, or Sun Antardasha, Saturn Antardasha. So in these four cases, this transit will be very crucial for you. And as per Jaimini Astrology's Charadasha system, the sign where your Saturn or your Sun is in your birth chart, because Jaimini is sign-based dashas. Sorry. So in that case, if you are running that, so suppose your Sun is in Leo. So then if you are running Virgo Mahadasha and Leo Antardasha, okay, or Leo Mahadasha or Virgo or any Antardasha, then this transit is very important for you. And the primary key holders for the stakeholders, I would say, for this transit is the houses which Saturn rules in your chart, depending on your ascendant. They are the most crucial houses, because ultimately, either it is dasha or transit, the planets have the agenda of the houses which they rule. So therefore, the houses which Saturn rules, ultimately they will be the limelight during this transit. If you are running these dashas in Vimshottari or Charadasha sometimes, and sometimes people also tell me that I am not running these Charadashas, but why am I still feeling this transit so intensely? Well, because if you know a bit of Gemini astrology, you will know that in Gemini, the planets, the Rashis have aspects, alright? So, if your Saturn is in Leo, for example, so as per Gemini Charadasha system, the sign Leo is a fixed sign, so it aspects the other movable signs except the one next to it. So therefore, except Cancer, which is just next to it, it will aspect Aries, it will aspect Libra, it will also aspect Capricorn, yes. So then this Saturn from Leo is aspecting Aries, Libra and Capricorn. So therefore, if you have the dasha of either Aries or Libra or Capricorn, provided your Saturn is in Leo, then also you will feel the effects of this transit very strongly. And if you want to know the rules of Gemini, then the movable signs aspect the other fixed signs except the one next to it. And the dual signs aspect the other three dual signs. So if your Saturn is in Sagittarius, if you are born in 89, 88 or 90 around that time, then your Saturn will aspect the sign of Gemini, then Pisces, and then Virgo, of course. So therefore, if you have Saturn in Sagittarius and you are running the dasha of other dual signs, then also this transit is very important, okay? And generally, what happens during retrogression? So first, let's discuss what Uttarashada is all about. Uttarashada is a very interesting nakshatra, because there's this dual confluence within the nakshatra. Why do I say that? Because Uttarashada falls, the first pada falls in Sagittarius, and then the second, third and fourth pada falls in the sign of Capricorn, as you know. And Sagittarius is ruled by Jupiter and Capricorn is ruled by Saturn, of course, but Sun is the ruler. So this is a very dynamic energy, because when it is in the first pada, the Lord of the zodiac sign is a great friend of the Nakshatra Lord, which means Jupiter is a great friend of the Sun. And then you come to Capricorn, Saturn and Sun, they are not friends, they are enemies. So therefore, during this nakshatra, it's a very beautiful time from May to September to admit things that you have never admitted to yourself. Why do I say that? Because Sun Saturn energy, see, they're not exactly enemies. Of course they are enemies, but it doesn't mean that they are trying to kill each other. It doesn't mean that. It means that sometimes in life, you might make certain decisions out of audacity and then later on realize that you actually did not want to make those decisions. You just made it because somebody else told you to make it. Or you had the audacity to prove everybody that, no, I am better than everybody else. And that is why I made this decision. And now you are regretting, you are lamenting, you're unhappy because of your decisions. So therefore, during this nakshatra transit, because this will be only, this transit is only within Uttarashada. So this transit will give you beautiful opportunities to connect with the universe also. Why do I say universe? Because Uttarachara is very closely related to Vishwa Devatas, the universal gods. So, therefore, during this time, we have to understand that the universe will send us many signals. The universe can send us signals to anybody, through ourself, our own mind, our own intelligence, our mother, father, our husband, wife, children, daughter, son, our guru, or through anybody. So during this time, it is highly crucial that we do proper meditation, because this transit can reveal answers to us which we never could have got through any other means, because the Vishwa Devatas will be guiding the universe during this transit. And when they are guiding us, we know that whatever is going to happen or whatever is happening is in the larger good of the universe, even though it might apparently seem that things are not the way we want, or he wants, or she wants. And especially that's very conducive with the current energy of this coronavirus which is going on. Why do I say that? Because now there are so many people, thousands, lakhs, millions, and maybe billions of people who are getting affected by this. I don't mean to say that billions are getting this virus and they are going to hospitals or they are dying, but there's this fear, what will happen? So because of this fear, many people I know, they have now started inquiring about higher truths of life, because people have realized how superficial their lives are, materialistic people, most of them. And why they have realized this? Because they have seen that one small thing comes and then everything is ruined. Now, when I say that everything is ruined, I don't mean that all the people of this world, they have caught this virus, but you have seen how the economies have gone down, how people are losing their jobs, people, they're having problems in relationships, they're having problems in health, they're having fear, there's panic all over. So therefore, people, they have realized, and so many, I have got literally hundreds of mails where people have told me that, is this what life is about? We are just fearful and we are just sitting in the home doing nothing. Maybe we are doing work, because most of the companies have declared home office. But is this what life is all about? Imagine what you are doing. Imagine if this virus would not come, we would be going on like this, and like going to work and coming and then eating food, enjoying TV, and then just sleeping at the end of the day, doing nothing good actually for ourselves or for the universe or for others. But this virus has given us this indication that you need to look for deeper things within your life. You must look for a spiritual upliftment, for spiritual elevation. You must look for a spiritual connection with God. That is the most important thing which this virus has taught people. And now gradually people are introspecting. Different countries, leaders, they are trying to introspect why this virus came, how can we do things which can protect people better in the future. All right, and people at an individual level, I know they are trying to cleanse their food habits. And in fact, recently one person, he had mailed me that he came to know that this virus has come from sources like bats or any other animals especially. And so he mailed me that he always used to see my videos, and he used to always hear that I used to tell that don't eat meat, don't kill animals, don't torture them, don't murder them, don't take part in this wretched, cruel animal meat industry, what they do, because if you do, then you will face karmic consequences. And now look what's happening in the world. So then he told me that I always wanted to leave, but there was that one final push which I needed. And when I saw that this virus has wreaked havoc, so then he told me that I have promised to myself, to God, to universe, and to you, which means to me, that I will never eat meat in this life again. because I don't know what will happen. I do not want to be the cause of distress to the universe. So there you see how the Vishwadevatas are playing role. So therefore, from May to September, you will see that many people will become more aware of good eating a vegetarian diet, not eating animals. They will be trying to go into rehabilitation centers, then de-addiction centers, then they will be trying to improve their life. Why? Because now they have become humble. Yes, they have actually not become humble. They have been humiliated. Big countries, big leaders, India, US, Germany, Russia, all the leaders of the countries, they have been humiliated because they have seen how tiny and how helpless they are. Of course, now you could claim that some countries have controlled this virus, but you have seen how one small virus, the virus is so small, you can't even see. So this just one small tiny thing that has gone inside from China or Wuhan or from wherever, whichever part of the universe it has come, or from whichever animal or bird or plant, wherever this from, whichever source this has come, this has humiliated all the countries of the world. Mother Nature, the universe has shown that if you continue to do cruel activities, I don't care who you are, either you are USA, you are India, you are Russia, you are Germany, no, you will be punished. And this is what is happening. Now more and more the cases are going up. And that is why the good thing that has happened is more and more people are inquiring now. They are sending mails to me, and when I talk to people, they tell me, I think people should really stop eating meat, and people should elevate their consciousness. Just by not eating meat and just eating vegetables will not do no good to your life. That there are many vegetarians in this world, but there are still so many problems. So just superficially shifting to a so-called vegetarian diet is not going to do a much greater good to this world. Yes, that is the first step. But the most important is we try to find deeper meaning within our life, because Uttara Shada also shows humility. Yes, there are many reasons why it shows. I won't go into the details. So now you will see that people, big leaders, they have been humiliated. People, they have felt that we have been humbled by this virus, and therefore now is the time that we try to find deeper meaning of within our daily life, because otherwise our life was just like a robot, like a machine. Just recall the last 20, 30, 40, 50 years of your life. Every day morning you are getting up, and just like a robot routine, you are doing the same thing. Weekends are coming, you are just wasting time, watching TV, doing all the nonsense, doing gossip, discussing who is having an affair with whom, who won the cricket match, which cricketer is getting married to which film star, all this useless, filthy, disgusting rubbish of this material world, which is not going to help you. So then the question is, what is going to help you? What is that which will elevate my consciousness? What is that which will make me happy ultimately? All right. And even if you read the Vishnu Sahasranam, there also Dharmaraj Yudhishthir asks this question to Bhishma Pitama. Kime kam devatam loke kimva pe kam parayanam. Yes, very beautiful. You can read the Vishnu Sahasranam. I know many people who are reading, but they are not reading with the meaning, so they don't know what is this. So then Bhishma answers very beautifully, Jagat Prabhum Deva Devam Anantam Purushottamam. So you must read it, and there Bhishma finally he speaks directly about Lord Krishna there. So therefore, if you want to really use this transit properly, then we must understand that there is a deeper meaning to life. Life is not just going to job, doing your business, or earning money, or getting married, having kids, having sex, and buying a car, and then just going to sleep, doing nothing, the same old boring stuff every day. So therefore, we must read the Vishnu Sahasranam. That will really help us. Yes. And the Bhagavad Gita is very essential because during when this Bhagavad Gita was spoken, this is Krishna is speaking to Arjuna. So that time, if you see, I will try to show, but I don't know if it is here. Let me check. There's this universal form which Krishna had showed to Arjuna. Or you can find it. You can type Virat Swarup. You will find. It's there. You see here. Okay. So if you see this photo. So this is the photo which I'm trying to show you. This one. All right. This photo. So this actually is the universal form which Lord Krishna was showing to Arjuna here. Okay. So if you read, I don't know if you can read what's written. Upon seeing the universal form of Krishna, Arjuna was wonder struck and said, "O Lord of the universe, O universal form, I see in your body many, many arms, bellies, mouths and eyes expanded everywhere without limit. I see in you no end, no middle and no beginning." All right. So this is a very interesting verse. This is in the 11th chapter, 16th verse. This is very crucial. And this verse actually tells us, you know, like even in scriptures, it is said about 12 sakshis. You know, there are 12 witnesses. So many times the modern materialistic, egoistic, I would say, non-materialistic, I would say the egoistic, atheistic modern people, they think that they are like God. They can do whatever they want, wherever they want, anything, anywhere, anytime. So they think they are all powerful. They can do whatever they want with whomever they want, you know, wherever, to what, whichever extent they want. So this current situation which we all are in, this has given us the indication that you are not God. Don't pretend to be God. Don't pretend to be all powerful. Yes, you need to understand the scriptural truths, and only then you shall realize that every living being, as they say, Jivera Swarup Hoi Krishnera Nitya Das, every living being is eternally a servant of God. And only when you serve God, you can be happy. Because when you get, you are not happy. You are happy, but the giver is more happier than the one who receives. Okay. So therefore, during these crucial times, it's very crucial that we read scriptures like the Bhagavad Gita, because otherwise we won't know anything what is going on. Now today this virus is there, and tomorrow maybe this virus disappears, and then after some days again some new virus will come. All right, there was this SARS, then there was Ebola, so many these things keep coming out. Just because tomorrow or maybe this virus disappears, it doesn't mean that some after 1 year, after 6 months, there will be no new virus. Okay, so the point is not in anticipating a new virus. The point is to understand that we have a deeper meaning in life, and when you read the Bhagavad Gita, so you will understand. So for example, here in the 10th chapter, if you read here, this is a very beautiful verse. Okay, one of my favorite verses. 8th verse from the 10th chapter, it said here, Aham sarvasya prabhavo matta sarvam pravartati iti matva bhajante ma buddha bhava samandita. So Krishna is telling to Arjuna here, I am the source of all spiritual and material worlds. Everything emanates from me. The wise who perfectly know this engage in my devotional service and worship me with all their hearts. And the next verse is really, really, really very beautiful. Matchitta madgata prana bodhayanta parasparam kathayantascha mam nityam tushyanti charamanti cha. So, the thoughts of my pure devotees dwell in me. Their lives are fully devoted to my service, and they derive great satisfaction and bliss from always enlightening one another and conversing about me. So many times people have asked me that we are just sitting home doing nothing. I've been fired from my job, or my company has declared home office. I'm getting bored. I'm lonely. I'm alone. I feel that I should go out. What should I do? Well, this is what you should do. The thoughts of my pure devotees dwell in me. Their lives are fully devoted to my service. And they derive great satisfaction and bliss from always enlightening one another and conversing about me. Yes, this is what you should do if you are bored sitting in the home doing nothing. All right. So in the 11th verse, it is said, Tesham eva anukampartham aham agyana jamtama nashayam yatma bhavastho jnana dipena bhasuta. To show them special mercy, I dwelling in their hearts, destroy with the shining lamp of knowledge the darkness born of ignorance. So there's a lot of darkness currently. We don't know what to do, what will happen. And the future seems to be very dark. And there are many scientists, researchers, and astrologers also who have been giving a lot of predictions. This will happen, that will happen. Well, irrespective of those things, they come out true or they come out false. We have to understand that unless we elevate our consciousness, it is of no good use. Today, there's this virus. Tomorrow, it may go down. And then after 6 months, some other virus may come. All right? And when we continue to read the Bhagavad Gita, then we will realize, as I said in the earlier verse, you know, they derive great satisfaction and bliss from always enlightening one another and conversing about me. So therefore, if you are bored, you are sitting and doing nothing in your home, then you should converse about the Bhagavad Gita, because Krishna says, you know, they derive great pleasure. Even if you are not deriving pleasure now, you are feeling bored even to read the Bhagavad Gita, keep doing it. Gradually you will get interested, okay? And finally, what does Arjuna say? Param Brahma, Param Dhamma, Pavitram, Paramam Bhavan, Purusham Shashvatam, Divyam Adi Devam Ajam Vibhum, Ahustvam Rishaya Sarve Devar Shinara Dastatha, Asito Deva Lovyaso, Swayam Chaiva, Vyasa Swayam Chaiva Bravishime. Arjuna said, Why I am reading this verse? Because this after this verse will tell you what happened to Arjuna after he heard from Krishna. You are the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the ultimate abode, the purest, the absolute truth. You are eternal, transcendental, original person, the unborn, the greatest. All the great sages such as Narada, Asita, Devala and Vyasa confirm this truth about you. And now you yourself are declaring to me. Alright, so Arjuna is very pleased. He is, all his doubts have been dispelled now. Alright, and as in the another sloka he says, which I am searching but I am not able to find. he says, Karishye vachanam tava nashto mohasmriti labdha tvatprasadan maya chuta sthitosmi gata sandeha. Then all my illusion and my darkness have been dispelled, and now I will do what you say. Alright, there are so many verses, I am not able to find which chapter this verse is. Alright, some other time. So therefore, the conclusion is that the Vishwadevatas are hinting us now, or because Saturn has already entered Uttarashada long time back, even before January when it was in Sagittarius. That we really need to change our life. We really need to do things which are more meaningful rather than just going to job, going to office or getting married. And not that we don't do all these things and we go to the forest. No, that's not the point here. Point is that we should try to elevate our consciousness by reading scriptures like the Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam. And only by that we can realize that our lives are meant for a deeper purpose. And I will end this video by chanting the last shloka from the Gita. Alright, 18th chapter, 78th verse. This is the last verse from the Bhagavad Gita. Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna Yatra Partho Dhanurdhara Tatra Shrir Vijayo Bhutir Dhruva Nitir Matir Mama. Who is telling this? Sanjaya is telling this to Dhritarashtra. Wherever there is Krishna, the master of all mystics, and wherever there is Arjuna, the supreme archer, there will also certainly be opulence, victory, extraordinary power and morality. That is my opinion. All right. opulence, victory, extraordinary power and morality. That is my opinion. And this is very true because the Mahabharata describes in detail the reign of Yudhishthira Maharaj for 36 years which he ruled after the Kurukshetra war. His kingdom, Hastinapur, Indraprasth, they were more opulent, they were more prosperous, they were more dharmic, more religious, more spiritual, even than Indra, the king of the heavens, his cities, you know, Amaravati, Alkapuri, these cities. So it was like heaven on earth. Yes, of course, because he was Yudhishthira Maharaj himself. That is why he is known as Dharmaraj. Just imagine the kingdom which Yudhishthira Maharaj would be ruling, headed by under guidance of Krishna, then Vidura, and with the support of all of his brothers like Bhim, Arjun, Nakul, Sahadev, and Draupadi beside him. And of course, Drona and Bhishma did not live, unfortunately, to see this. But at the end, they were coronated as the emperor of the as the kings of this world, and then they started. That is why it is like, as they say, when it was Lord Ram's time, Ram Navami is coming. You know? I'll make videos, but even for Lord Ram, they say Ram Rajya, yes, where the deer and the tiger would drink water from the same pond. Yes, many skeptics, many people who cannot accept things, simple things, they argue, they always argue with me. How in the universe is it possible that a deer and a tiger can drink water simultaneously from the same pond, from the same lake? Because they are enemies. Yes, whenever the deer is visible, the tiger will just run and try to kill it. But yes, that is what is Ram Raj. Therefore, we may not be able to establish Ram Raj or the reign of Yudhishthira Maharaj, but at least at our level, if we try to change things and read the scriptures, take enlightenment from our gurus, from our god brothers, our god sisters, and our seniors within the spiritual community, then we shall be able to elevate our consciousness and gradually realize that there is much more to life than what it seems. Alright, thank you very much, and as usual, if you are new to the channel, then please subscribe to it down below, and if you want a consultation from me, then please go down to the website again down right in the description section. And God is there with you all the time. Just look to him and you will find him. Thank you very much.